Welcome. My name is Jacco Hoekstra. I'm one of the professors of this faculty and also one of the lecturers of the Introduction to Aerospace Engineering lecture. And I will give two short explanations of the physics of flight. In the first one, we will look at the lift force. It is one of the mysteries of flight. In fact, not so long ago, a famous physicist like Lord Kelvin of the temperature unit has stated that it would be impossible to fly with anything heavier than air. He was proven wrong only 8 years later by the Wright brothers, who made their Wright flyer. And then 100 years later, roughly 100 years later, we were able to make even larger airplanes like the A380. And also the way in which we flew changed radically from lying on a wing in the wind to watching a movie while you fly from Paris to New York. Something of which the Wright brothers said it would never be possible to begin with, flying from Paris to New York. Of course not. And we do it now, regularly. How do we do this? What is the trick, the secret of flight? Well, if you look at the physical principle, there are actually three different principles. The first one is being lighter than air. The second is pushing air downwards. Action is reaction. And the third is pushing something else downwards, like with the rocket. And this is also roughly the historical order in which we learned to fly. The first one, being lighter than air, invented by the Montgolfier brothers, who, benefiting from the fact that their father had a wallpaper factory, did experiments with balloons. And these balloons got larger and larger, and at some point they were at the point that they could put humans in it, after testing it with some animals to see if a human would survive if it would go higher in the atmosphere. Of course, birds would survive, but if the sheep would also survive, then probably humans would also survive and they go up. The king, who sponsored the experiments, the ever larger balloons, then proposed to put some prisoners underneath the balloon to test whether humans could fly. But there were actually two volunteers, D'Arlandais and de Roger, who said, well, we think it's quite an honor to be the first one to fly. So they volunteered and did this first flight. In fact, nowadays, hot air balloons are in French called Montgolfiers, and helium balloons are still called Rogiers, in honor of these pioneers. And this was actually the way which we flew into the 20th century. Here we see the Hindenburg, which in 1937 made a promotion tour across the US to promote the technology of flying. Unfortunately, they were lacking helium then, so they used hydrogen, but that even provides more lift, but is also combustible. So when a spark, due to static electricity, ignited the paint on the cloth, then together with this hydrogen caused this huge disaster. Was this the reason that we don't fly with balloons and airships anymore? Not really. Let's look at the physics to understand it a bit better. The physics of balloon flight are called aerostatics. And the physics are based by looking at the pressure in the atmosphere. And if we take a certain volume of air, let's look at this volume of air, then we know that due to the weight, the specific weight, this volume of this volume has a certain weight. The air has weight as well. So there is a gravity force acting on it. But if there's equilibrium, it means that the air pressure around it apparently is able to generate an equal force up, and therefore the air stays where it is. Well, the idea of aerostatics is that we take out this volume of air and replace it with something else. So if we take, for instance, cold air, but we replace it with hot air, then the pressure around it is still the same, but the weight due to the lower density of hot air is actually less, 25% less. And the difference is the lift you can generate this way. If we do not use hot air, but a gas like helium, for instance, then we get even 86% less weight, because it's only 14% of the weight of the air. So that's a lot more lift. And hydrogen weighs half what helium weighs. And then you can reduce this difference with the 100% by factor 2. And therefore, this creates 94% less weight, so 94% of the weight as lift. In the physical formula, we would say that the lift force is equal to the weight of the air multiplied by the reduction factor, because you put something lighter in it. And this would look like this. You take the specific weight, the density of the air, multiplied by the volume to get the mass of this air, multiplied by the gravity constant to get the weight of the air. And then based on the difference in density, you can calculate the reduction in weight by the gas, and therefore this is this factor, and these two are the lift formula for ballooning. Is this now the way to travel in the future? It's quite luxurious. So some say, yes, this is the future of sustainable air travel, because if you use helium, you get eternal lift for free. You don't need to burn fuel for it. You get the lift for free. But unfortunately, air weighs something, but it's not that heavy. So to have the lift, which has to be equal to the, can be at maximum equal to the weight of the air in that location, you need quite a large volume to get enough lift. And this is not a real problem until you start moving forward, because then this volume creates a lot of drag. And therefore, you still need to burn fuel then to get somewhere. So yes, it is a sustainable form to generate lift, but only if you're not going anywhere. But there is another mystery about the lift with balloon. And that is, if we take this helium balloon, and you can see that it generates lift, and we've investigated why, because the helium inside is lighter than the air around it, and that's why it generates lift. But if you look a bit closer, this balloon keeps its shape. It doesn't change shape. And that's because around the surface of the balloon, there is, at every location, an equilibrium of forces, and therefore it stays as it is. However, if we would sum all these differences, all these zeros, then the total lift force should also be zero. But it's not. There is a lift force. So how does it actually work with this force? Where does this force come from? Okay, it's lighter than air, it wants to float. But how does it work with the forces? Well, to understand that, we discover a principle which is actually very important for aeronautics in general. The reason is that on the top side of the balloon, the pressure is a bit lower than on the bottom side, where there's a higher pressure. And if you would look at the difference, then for every meter altitude, you would have a 1.225 kilogram per square meter less weight pressing on it when you go higher. And this depends a bit on the weather, the temperature, but roughly this is the number. This is the effort number. If we look at the pressure at sea level, you often hear the number 1,113.25 millibar, maybe. But it also can be mentioned that it's actually 101,000 newton per square meter. And maybe this doesn't mean that much to you yet, but this is actually the same as over 10,000 kilograms per square meter. It's actually the pressure at sea level. And the reason is that there is indeed over 10,000 kilograms of air above you. So, because if we have a table, it presses on it, but it also presses on the lower side, then, of course, you don't notice this immense pressure. But there is an immense force that allows us to do something with it. And this is what hints at the second principle, pushing air downwards, because it's also about pressure differences. If we look at this airplane, the A380, and we look at the weight, and we look at the wing surface area, then we can calculate per square meter what the wing carries, the wing loading. If we then look at the pressure difference that would be required between the top and bottom side of the wing to carry this weight, you could see that this is also 600 kilograms per square meter, the wing loading. And then we can see what actually the total pressure is, 10,000 over 10,000. You could see this is almost 6% of pressure difference between the top side of the wing and the lower side of the wing, and this is what generates the lift. How does the wing do this? Well, often you hear it's because the top side of the wing has a curvature, more curvature than the lower side, and therefore it has to go faster. And indeed, if we take two sheets of paper and we blow a bit of air in between, then due to the higher speed, there is indeed a lower pressure and the sheets fold together. And this is what generates the lift. However, there is a reason why this explanation is often not right. There is no reason that the longer way on the top side makes it go faster, because they don't want to arrive there at the same time. In fact, if you look at this animation, you see that the top one is even at the end of the wing faster than the lower part. There's no reason that they should meet there at the same time. And therefore, it's not the correct explanation. The correct explanation is closer to this. If you would look at the wind tunnel, which has a smaller section in the middle, and the same amount of air goes in as goes out, which has to be, because where does it go otherwise? Then in the middle, it has to go faster because there's less space. And if you then replace the lower side by this curved airfoil, this curved wing shape, you can see that it's actually the same. Only there's no top side, but the air just goes straight, but it doesn't matter for the lower side. So the fact that air is pushed away is causing the higher speed, and that is causing the lift, and that's indeed due to the pressure difference that you have with the higher speed. But this can also be calculated in a more physical, mathematical way. And therefore, we have to look at what this lift force depends of wing. Of course, it's the speed at which you travel, but also the surface area of the wing, the air density, the air pressure, and the shape of the flow in the wing, as well as the angle under which the air meets the wing. If you look at these quantities and we put them in a formula by giving them names, we can see that the lift can be expressed in this way. Lift is the lift coefficient for the shape and the angle of attack, half rho v squared for the density and the speed, times the surface area. This half rho v squared is what we call the dynamic pressure. It's actually the same as what you would feel if you would hold your hand outside the car window. The half rho v squared is the pressure you feel against your hand. And as the lift coefficient is dependent on the angle of attack, we can make a little graph of this. And then we can see that there is even a point where this lift coefficient is 1. That means that what the wing then would feel in terms of lift is the same as if you would have this whole airplane in the wrong direction in the flow, feel this dynamic pressure. That's actually the force that the wing generates in terms of lift. So it's an immense force. But luckily for us, the plane is not oriented like this in the flow, but horizontally. But there is still a price to pay in terms of drag. And that will be discussed in the next lecture.